last week was the Super Bowl. Whether your team won or lost, we can all agree on one thing. Football is now done for the year. Unless, of course, you like the XFL, which I have no understanding of. So I'm just going to suggest we turn the page, because spring training is upon us. Pitchers and catchers report starting this week. Yeah, join in. Ball game, take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I ever get back, cause it's root, root, root for the Dodgers. But they don't win, it's a shame, cause it's one, two, three strikes, you're out at the old ball game. There you go. So let's talk a little baseball. And no, as a Padre fan, I have nothing to say about the Red Sox trade with the Dodgers this past week. Nothing at all. Instead, in 1977, Reggie Jackson was a celebrated free agent who joined the New York Yankees. The player who would become known as Mr. October due to his on-the-field prowess in the postseason did not lack for confidence. In fact, not long after his arrival in New York, he made headlines when it was reported that in an interview while speaking about the highly respected Yankee captain, Thurman Munson, Jackson said, or perhaps implied, that he, Jackson, not Munson, was the straw that stirred the drink for the Yankees. At the time, this was quite the salty proposition, and it set in motion what would be a contentious relationship with then Yankee manager Billy Martin, owner George Steinbrenner, the New York media, and well, the entire fan base as well. Confidence is a good thing, but when it begins to stray into the realm of arrogance, well, that's something completely different. And that line, which can be a fine one, is often a matter of perspective. After all, when Jackson backed up his words and played incredibly well in the postseason, much of the chirping subsided, except for what was coming from the manager, but that's an entirely different story. There have always been big personalities making big statements. The bigger the stage, the bigger the splash, and in an era of 24-hour news and the constant buzz of social media, this is truer today than ever. We're living in an era marked by provocative statements and grandstanding being perpetrated by large personalities across the landscape of our nation and world. Celebrities, star athletes, politicians are among the high-profile people who make headlines by making big statements or hot takes. And friends, we are at the front end of an election year, so it's only going to happen more. Depending on where we sit in relation to these big personalities, whether we like them or agree with them, or whether we find what they are saying abhorrent, we will react very differently. The line between confident and arrogant can often come down to a matter of perspective. And where we stand in relationship to that line can serve to divide us even more than we are already divided. It may be more prevalent in our time, but this is not a new phenomenon. Imagine, just for a moment, that you were a Jewish person in the first century living in Palestine. And you would come to hear Jesus preach at this stage in his ministry, the stage when our passage occurs. You probably knew very little about him since he had just begun. Perhaps you had heard some stories about how he had been preaching and teaching and healing people in Galilee. The stories were impressive enough that you thought maybe you should go and be part of a fairly large crowd that had gathered to listen to what he had to say. He starts off by talking about blessings. And it makes you feel good because you can place yourself in one or more of the categories of people he says, are blessed. Then he says something weird about salt and light. But you'll give that a little more thought later. Because then he goes for it. He makes the provocative statement. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. Even though he keeps talking, that is the salty proposition. If there were 24-hour news sources, that would be the top of the hour tease. If Facebook existed, that is the statement that would be blowing up people's news feeds. If Twitter were a thing, the tweets would be flying, and hashtag not to abolish but to fulfill would be trending. Well, you get the point. New guy on the scene claims that he will fulfill the ancient prophecies. Wow. From our 21st century perspective, we have the great benefit of loads of context. To begin with, we have Jesus' full story, and we know how 2,000 years of Christian tradition has interpreted these words within the larger collection of all of Jesus' teaching. We also know that there are layers of purpose to such a statement, one of which is to counter the idea that the Christian movement was intended to somehow replace Judaism, and instead was part of the continuing revelation of God in the world. But in that moment, how it must have sounded. This carpenter from Nazareth, claiming that he had come to fulfill the law and the prophets, essentially to bring into being the hopes and dreams of the Jewish people. Talk about being the straw that stirs the drink. For many, such a statement was blasphemous. And we see the evidence of that in the words and actions of the religious leaders of his time, those about whom we read who sought to discredit Jesus and ultimately to bring him up on charges. But for others, these were words that embodied great hope, as they suggested that generations of waiting and hoping and praying for the Messiah might be coming to an end. How about that? People finding themselves with differing views about a leader and a provocative statement made by that leader. Huh. Depending on how you felt about the statement and the person, you would think that the statement made Jesus sound, well, either supremely confident or horribly arrogant. Again, depending on which side of the line you stood on. But I might suggest that, as with all things, setting aside preconceived notions, tabling the debate about confidence versus arrogance, actually considering the context is vital in how we interpret the message behind this particular salty proposition. Rather than give in to the temptation to isolate the single provocative statement just because it is trending, does not mean that this is where our attention belongs. Instead, we might ask ourselves, what does it mean to fulfill the words of the prophets and the law? In the case of this particular moment, we have seen clear hints surrounding the statement itself. For just prior in this portion of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, Jesus spoke of salt and light. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Jesus uses these analogies to salt and light to suggest that the people of God have a calling, a purpose in this world. It is not about him, it's about all of us. Salt, after all, is not intended to be a standalone flavor. I have a friend who's an aspiring amateur chef, and he talks about how salt is a seasoning that is added to a dish not to change the flavors, but to encourage the other flavors to come out. We all know what happens when you add too much salt to something. It becomes, well, salty. Virtually inedible. But the right amount of salt, that brings the flavors to life. Jesus' call to us to be the salt of the earth is a call to engage with the people of our world, to be the seasoning that brings to life the flavors present in those with whom we live, with whom we work, with whom we worship, with whom we share this earth, to strive against the blandness of life. light in itself is not intended to be a standalone feature. Unless, of course, you're trying to get someone to come to your car lot or dance club by shining a light straight up in the sky and moving it around a little bit. Light illuminates that upon which it is cast. With light, we are able to see details and contrasts. We're able to discern color and shape. Light, by its nature, draws attention to other things, allowing them to be seen. Jesus' call to us to be the light of the world is a call to shine our light so that others may be seen, to provide a sense of illumination so that the eyes of all people can be opened to see the wonder and beauty of the world and its people, to bring light to places that would otherwise be kept in the shadows. And this call was not unique to Jesus, who stood in a long line of Hebrew prophets and teachers. It echoes the words of the prophet Isaiah, who spoke of Israel being a light unto the nations. It's a reminder of the words of Micah, whose message we discussed last week, a message that encourages us as people of faith to be humble and to place our focus on others, remembering that we are interconnected. The claim of fulfillment, then, that Jesus makes is not an individual claim at all, but part of the broader call of Jesus, a call that echoes the call of God heard throughout the Hebrew Scriptures, grounded in the people's first covenants with God. And it is a call that resounds in the words of the apostles who built communities of faith tasked with service in and for their world. It's a call to hear and understand the values of our faith and to live them out boldly and brightly. Unlike so many of the provocative statements of our time, intended to bring the spotlight upon the person speaking, it is truly a salty proposition encouraging us to do just the opposite and shine our light outward, to reflect God's light and love into our world. And in that way, it flies in the face with what we are witnessing in our culture these days. Perhaps we might heed this lesson. In the days and weeks and months to come, perhaps we might reject the me first, me only messages that pervade our culture and divide our nation. On this day, when we will gather for our church's annual meeting, making decisions that impact who we are as a church, perhaps we might listen to the message of Jesus asking us, encouraging us, imploring us to be people who are salt, who are light, encouraging the flavor in others, illuminating the lives of others, so that all God's people might get in the game. Play ball.